Good afternoon. My name is Wilna Venter. I am from the research office at the University of Cape Town, South Africa. Today, I would like to discuss with you the important topic of research integrity and ethics. Now, what I'm going to do is to firstly give you a brief background that will inform you where we are or why we are where we are. After that, I will give you a short definition of what is meant by research integrity and ethics. I will touch on responsible conduct of research, and then I will inform you of NIH compliance requirements in regard to research integrity and ethics. In terms of background, before World War II, society had very little interest and concern with research and researchers. They were more or less left by themselves to determine how they conduct research. After what came out in the Nuremberg trials, where the atrocities and the brutality that happened in Nazi concentration camps, society became more concerned about research and ethics. From that point onwards, researchers had to be clear on how they conduct their research. However, it was still up to the researcher to decide the extent to which they engage with being accountable. It was only in 1964 that there has been more or less a worldwide attempt to establish an international model according to which researchers had to conduct themselves ethically. Declaration of Helsinki, 1964. This declaration has subsequently been revised, and currently there is a call for the public to contribute to towards this revision. The basic bottom line with this declaration is that scientific review needs to happen prior to a research project being embarked on. It is only after the Belmont report was released in 1979 that there was a realization of individuals or individual researchers not being able to stick to ethical requirements. Subsequently, governments had to intervene and design and draft regulation to guide research, responsible conduct of research. In 2010, a number of delegates from all over the world came together and formulated the Singapore Statement on Research Integrity. We are currently in a situation where globally there is an attempt to have more or less uniform regulation informed by governments. Independent laws in this regard. What do we mean by research integrity? Research integrity is not merely a dictation from outside. There should be active adherence to the ethical principles and professional requirements that constitute responsible conduct of research. Research integrity is integrally part of all the stages of the research process, from the planning of research, to conducting the research, to dissemination of results. There are a number of sources guiding responsible conduct of research. There are the professional codes, government regulation, institutional policies, and once again, importantly, personal values and responsibilities. There are quite a number of codes or principles, ethical principles, underlying codes and policies. Responsible conduct of research. Now, what I'm trying to do here is to point out the different levels in which conduct, responsible conduct of research, need to have conscious awareness of. And I'm going back to where we started off in terms of human subjects. I've already made reference to the Belmont report in 1979, where the three basic principles has been respect for autonomy, basically meaning that a research or a human subject participating in research has got the autonomy to decide whether he or she wants to be part of this research or not. Secondly, you need to determine whether the benefit of particular research outweighs the cost and the risks involved in the research. Justice is another crucial principle where the benefit of research cannot be deprived from those that should be on the receiving end of it. Issues to consider is when you engage or when you embark on research, you really need to ask yourself, is it really necessary to involve human subjects? Secondly, you need to comply with regulations, whether it's government regulations or institutional regulations. In your interaction with human subjects, you need to allow them the right to decide whether they want to be part of it or not. Therefore, you need to promote responsible use of human subjects. Animal subjects, equally important. There is also a long history behind the Animal Act, which was formulated in 1987. Started off in the 1800s, and the main concern here is you need, or what is very difficult when it comes to using animal subjects in research, is determining what is and what is not humane treatment of animals, and how humanity can benefit from scientific results emanating from research involving human or animal subjects. Publications and authorship. This is a very important area. The reason is that publications is central to conducting research. If you don't publish it, your research is useless. But it comes with responsibility. You need to publish for the sake of making your science known and not for the sake of promoting yourself. Another issue tied to this is authorship. Who is an author? And there are very clear guidelines. It's the person that engages in the scientific scope of a research project. It's a person that is integrally part of drafting a report based on the research project, or a person that has given the final review before submission of a research project. Biosecurity. Biosecurity evolves around the issue of dual use research. What is dual use research? It's any research in the life sciences that could result in or could be used for malicious purposes like biological warfare. Collaboration. In this day and age, collaboration is absolutely core to research for many reasons. Most of them are evident. The fact that an individual researcher cannot produce a rich source of information as can a group of researchers. Secondly, government is making it more and more compulsory that academics and industry should collaborate. But there is a responsibility here, and that is that all participants need to have a clear understanding. Therefore, there needs to be clear communication in order to make collaboration authentic and ethical. Conflict of interest. I'm sure many of you are quite familiar with this term that we use in everyday language, which basically means that an individual has an interest in the outcome of a particular activity. In this case, it would be research. And when that outcome actually could compromise the integrity of the research. Data management, once again, is about being responsible in how you collect data, in how you manage data, and how you disseminate data, how you analyze it, how you share it. The bottom line here is honesty, responsibility, respect, confidentiality, all the initial underlying principles I've mentioned to you comes to a play when we talk about data management. Mentoring. Mentoring is integrally part of responsible conduct of research. Basically, as a mentor, you, through your actions and also verbally, guide the next generation of scientists in how to conduct themselves responsibly. It is therefore integrally part of being a responsible researcher. Peer review. It is not only the scientist that is responsible for a particular piece of research. It is all the peer or all the reviewers that give a judgment on the truthfulness of the research. They are collectively accountable for the research, and they have the responsibility to keep themselves up to date with the development of a particular research area in order to be as good as peer reviewers they could be. Stem cell research is a very controversial area, and it the main issue here is fear of human cloning, but there has been strong regulation against human cloning. It is not allowed, and further regulations tightening down the extent to which stem cell research can happen. Research misconduct. Besides what I've mentioned to you previously, research conduct entails the deliberate fabrication, falsification of research, either by manipulating data or the analysis of data, or by making up data. It could also entail photoshopping, changing pictures. There are issues of self-plagiarism. When you publish basically the same piece of science under your name in multiple publications, but they are basically the same. Ghostwriting, for example, where pharmaceutical company is actually conducting the research, which is then published in your name. Whistleblowing, anybody that observes any misconduct in research has got the responsibility to divulge what they've observed. Now, usually there is the perception that it's only the accused, so-called accused, that suffers from or that is adversely affected, but also the whistleblower, him or herself, is subjected to ostracization. It is therefore very important that institutions have policies in place where the whistleblower is also protected. In terms of NIH and its compliance requirements, each institution that receives funding from federal government, in this instance also the NIH, basically need to have four policies in place. The first one is in regard to human subjects. The second one is in regard to animal subjects. An institution should also have research misconduct policies and conflict of interest policies. In regard to the first two, registration is required, which will allow for you to receive a federal-wide assurance number. In regard to both research on human subjects and research using animal subjects. I have reached the end of my presentation. I thank you for your patience.